our very first Chocolates from Cacao Farm to Bar webinar. Mabuhay! I am Iman Sugitan, and we are the co-founders of OFW Para sa Magsasaka,
or Overseas Foreign Workers in Support of Filipino Farmers. Course 1 is an introduction to chocolate farming. At the end of this course, students will be able to understand the crucial role of Philippine cacao beans in the booming global chocolate industry, have a basic understanding of the cacao tree and the crop, gain an insight to the long value chain of the cacao industry, appreciate the chocolate making process, and decide which course he would like to proceed in. Module Cacao 101 is a cacao to chocolate value chain and the opportunity for the Philippines.
But before we begin, a small background about us.
We're 13-year OFWs in Dubai, and some time ago, we decided to make healthier and tastier chocolates. So we went to Mindanao to study cacao production in Sidami, Cacao Industry Development Authority of Mindanao. And that is where we learned about the challenges of the farmers. Soon after, OFW Para sa Magsasaka, or OPM, was born.
OPM's mission are simple: to create social and economic impact for both OFW and Magsasaka, to create environmental impact, and to make it sustainable by making it commercially viable. And that is why OFW Para sa Magsasaka is a social enterprise. So let's begin our first module by understanding the cacao global supply and demand, the cacao value chain, and its stakeholders. During the course of our webinar, we will be taking from various sources, from lectures we've attended, seminars we've attended, books we've read, interviews we've done, not only in the Philippines, but also from different personalities and experts we have encountered outside of the Philippines. So, our first slide is taken from the presentation from the people from Bahi Kalbu, or the biggest processor of chocolates in the world. The global cocoa market. West Africa is the world's largest cocoa producer. The top three cocoa producing countries are Cote d'Ivoire, Ivory Coast, Ghana, and Indonesia. By now, as a farmer or a cacao producer, you should know that the Philippines is one of the very few countries who are able to cacao farm. Why? Because we are between the 20 degrees up and below the equator. So no matter how much people from Europe or from the US or from North America would like to farm cacao, they cannot. Let's look at the world statistics. About 70% of total cocoa beans come from West Africa. In this slide, you can see the cocoa bean crop by country origin.
Cacao, or cocoa, or its technical term Theobroma cacao, which roughly translates to food of the gods, is grown in hot climates 20 degrees north and 20 degrees south of the equator. In this narrow belt, the Philippines is ideally located. Now, even in that narrow belt, not all beans are the same. Later on, our chocolate maker and cacao doctor, Lucci, will explain to us what difference it makes when the region where the cacao grown is nearer to the equator or when it's farther to the equator. She will also explain to us what terroir means and what flavor the terroir contributes to the final flavor of the chocolate.
Now, in Asia, Vietnam follows Indonesia in 2016 as the second Asian nation to be recognized by the International Cocoa Organization as a fine flavor cocoa origin. Now, what is the relevance to this for us Filipinos? It means that if we, or when we become the third Asian nation to become a fine flavor cocoa origin, we too will be able to demand premium prices for our cocoa beans, our nibs, our cocoa products, and even our chocolates. Now, what is the status of cocoa in the Philippines? About 12,000 tons are produced annually, and 80% comes from the Davao region, which I'm sure all of you want to change because you're going to farm more in your region. It is a smallholder farmer industry, which means about 1.5 hectares is being farmed by a cocoa farmer. It is mostly organic by default. It represents about only 0.2% of world production. So we are contributing as a nation such a small percentage to the world's supply. An area of about 20,000 hectares and about 16,000 farmers are right now being used for cacao farming. Now, domestically, it means in our local market, the deficit is about 40,000 tons per year of cocoa bean equivalents. It's being estimated that from 100,000 tons to about 1 million metric tons will be the shortfall by 2020. This is a trend of the world cocoa production since the 1900s.
If you've tuned in to listen to this Chocolates from Cacao Farm to Bar webinar, chances are you're relatively new to the cacao industry. We'd like to emphasize that no amount of webinar can replace learning by actual farming. Getting your hands dirty, sweating it out, makagat ng tagnok, ng lamok, whether in the farms to take care of your seedlings or trees, or in the kitchen to really make those chocolates. So please don't expect that after this webinar you'll be an expert. No, this is just the beginning of your long journey, and you may very well want to attend a real farm training or try cacao farming on your own piece of land after this. Or maybe you'll be like Luchi, who after attending Sidami's cacao doctor's training, building protocols with me in our own farms and our other cacao doctors, decided she really loves the part of chocolate making more. And so she enrolled in Eco Chocolat. Kaya ako ngayon ang magsasaka and siya ang kusinera ng chocolate. Last year, when we started OPM, we held those roadshows where we go for coffee, meeting OFWs all over the UAE. Just explaining to them why we're doing this social enterprise. And then we invite them if they'd like to be part of it. This small world that Luchi and I are used to opened up, and it's there we started hearing about OFWs who also invested in cacao farming while they were abroad with no real technical know-how. One particular Pinoy we met in Abu Dhabi when we had our roadshow was an accountant who we guessed studied the money part of cacao farming well, the financial part, because he's an accountant. So he ordered seedlings, according to him, had them shipped to Palawan, taga-Palawan siya. But he was so disappointed because his cacao farm failed. Ang naisip tuloy namin, ay naku, sayang. He spent about 100,000 pesos, sabi niya sa amin. Ipinatanim ko sa mga farmers. Siyempre, farmers sila, so assumed alam na nila dapat gawin. So we asked him, alam ba nila yung ideal hole size,
ilang days yung rest ng seedlings bago itanim, anong shade ginagamit, anong shade nung farm mo, coconut ba, banana, o monocrop ka ba, nagfronding ba kayo, nagmulching ba sila, marunong ba yung farmers mo magpruning? And his answer, hindi raw yata. So, we hope na we'll hear fewer stories if we can encourage people to learn the basics at least. And get information from reliable sources. About 60% of what you will hear in this webinar when it comes to farming, which is my part, are sidami materials or from lectures we attended in Davao. About 20% come from reading other published sources in the Philippines and abroad, countries like Ecuador, Papua New Guinea, Indonesia, and Vietnam. Then 20% are a combination of my experience managing our own OPM farms financially, managing my cacao doctors and in Agusan, and teaching our enrolled farmers at OPM. OPM farms are, by the way, right now, headquartered in the wet and very wet Agusan del Sur. Look at this as a journey. Marami pa tayong tutuntunin. And as journeys require that a driver understand well his map by learning terms and directions, so does a person who wants to learn cacao farming and chocolate making. I'll do a quick review of terms and concepts that will prove useful in this cacao webinar. There will be more terms as we go along, but basically, you should know these. Cacao industry. Cacao or cocoa? The answer is, these are the same. It really just depends on who's pronouncing it. Normally, the Westerners like calling it cocoa, but the people from Latin America and even for us in Asia, we simply call it cacao. Pods, hills, or trees. Basically, a pod is the fruit of the cacao tree. The photo you see right now on the lower right is an example of one pod. And inside it are the seeds, or what we call the beans. Now, the pods are, of course, tumutubo from trees. And normally, in the cacao industry, the trees are termed as hills. So later you might hear, ilang hills meron ka? It means, how many trees do you have? Wet beans and dry beans. The photo you see right now is a photo of wet beans. This can already be sold. It has already the white thing na sinisip-sip natin, and it also has the placenta, yung nasa gitna. The white thing is called the mucilage. And it's quite, if you haven't tasted it yet, it's sweet and a little bit sour, and somehow for me, it reminds me of santol. Now, dry beans. Dry beans means it has already been sun-dried or solar-dried or mechanical-dried. Any which way that the beans have already been removed of moisture. Now, FYI, if you are going to sell dry beans, the moisture content should be between 5 to 7.5% ideally. So, it means kailangan your beans should be really, really dry before you store them and would only have like 5% to 7.5% of moisture. Otherwise, you run the risk of accumulating or growing molds, and that will affect your chocolates or even your tableya later on. Or maybe when it reaches your buyer, then they will have problems. Pod index. The number of pods needed to produce 1 kilo of dried beans. It means how many pods, ilang bunga should you have so that you will have 1 kilo of dried beans. That means the skin has already been removed, the moisture has already been removed. This is what's called the pod index. Now, pod index varies from variety or from clone to clone. So later, you will see how certain clones have a higher pod index, which means you need more pods just to make 1 kilo. And some varieties need, because they have quite big beans, they don't need a lot of pods. So the pod index becomes lower. Now, what's bean recovery? This is the conversion from wet to dry. 33% or 3:1 is the average. Like I said, each clone would have, trees have different kinds of look, shape, and sizes of pods. It depends on what variety it is. So, but this 33% is the median, or it's actually the average. Generally, we say na, if you had 3 kilos of wet beans, like this photo, tanggalin yung skin, after drying, you would only have a third of it left. So that's why it's a 3:1. So if you had 3 kilos wet after drying, it's only 1 kilo. Because all the moisture have already been eliminated. Now, you might hear later on talk about 1 ton, 1 metric ton. Maybe some of you have already know this, especially if you're an engineer or maybe an architect. But for me, that's one of the things I asked when I first started learning about cacao farming. They kept talking about a metric ton. Ano ba ibig sabihin ng isang tonelada? It actually means 1,000 kilos. So if somebody tells you, alam mo, ang requirement namin is 5 tons of this cacao dried beans per month. Basically, that person is telling you that he needs 5,000 kilos because 1 metric ton is equal to 1,000 kilos. Monocrop or intercrop? As a farm owner or maybe a farm manager, or maybe if you will have or you're a farmer, you want to decide early on, will I go for monocrop, which means ang magiging main crop ko will be cacao, and still have a shade. By the way, you need to have a shade which will serve as a canopy to protect your cacao plants, because you cannot have too much sunlight. By the way, in the beginning, only 75%, you need to have 75% shade, at least in the first year. So you need to decide, will I go for monocrop? So I have my cacao seedlings, and then I'll have madre de cacao, which will serve as a shade. Or shall I have an intercrop, wherein your shade is probably coconuts or bananas, because it will serve as your canopy. So may instant ka na, meron ka ng instant shade. What I find though in the farms that we handle in OPM is that generally farms would have not just one crop or not just one intercrop. Normally, like for us, some of our farms, we have coconuts, and then alongside we have a few bananas, and then medyo a little bit of meron kang mahahanap na lansones, tas meron ding isa or dalawang jackfruit in 1 hectare, and this is actually quite healthy for the soil, for the farm. It's good for the environment. Later on, we will talk more about monocrop or intercrop. It means if you want, by the way, it doesn't mean monocrop is the same as intercrop. It's a question of, will you go for monocrop and have a plantation, or will you go for intercrop and have several crops in the same farm? Fermentation. No fermentation means no chocolate flavor. Now, I'd like to share with you, although most of you, I'm sure, if if somebody tells you it's fermented, ang suka fermented, ang mga liquor fermented, you might already have an idea what this chemical process is all about. Now let me just define it from Wikipedia. Fermentation is a metabolic process that converts sugar to acids, gases, or alcohol. It occurs in yeast and bacteria and also in oxygen-starved muscle cells, as in the case of lactic acid fermentation. Fermentation is also used more broadly to refer to the bulk growth of microorganisms on a growth medium, often with the goal of producing a specific chemical product. So this is exactly our goal in fermenting the cacao beans. Before we dry it, we'd like the metabolic process which converts yung sugar, which is found in the mucilage, kasi diba, I told you that it's sweet. So once the metabolic process converts the sugar to alcohol, doon lumalabas, that's where the chocolate flavor starts developing. And it's also in that process wherein you stop the germination process. So now, if you ferment, there's no chance na magiging seedling yung iyong bean. So that's fermentation. Again, no fermentation, no chocolate flavor. Perhaps you might get some flavor, but you're not really fully maximizing the potential to give that chocolate flavor to the beans if you don't ferment. Normally, or like maybe 99.9%, your buyers, chocolate makers, from abroad will want fermented dried beans. Cultural methods before chemical interventions. Cultural methods, it doesn't mean ito yung culture natin as a Filipinos. It simply means there are habits or there are actions, repeated actions, which you can do to your cacao trees without needing to introduce a chemical component. Example of cultural methods which are very, very important in cacao farming are, number one, pruning, number two, sleeving, mulching, round weeding. Later on in the succeeding modules, we will go to that further. But right now, you just need to know that before you start thinking, anong fertilizer yung bibilin ko? Bibili ba ako ng ganito, yung NPK? First, do the cultural methods because, for example, pest and disease management, that can be addressed through cultural methods first. And only go for chemical interventions if the cultural methods don't really work or it's, you know, you want a further boost. But always the cultural method, the pruning, the weeding, the all these fronding, all these have to take precedence before chemical interventions. Midges as pollinators. Kanina, I mentioned to you na makagat ng tagnok. I'm not sure in Tagalog if midges are also called tagnok, but in Visayan language, midges are called as such. And they are the very, very tiny insects who are the only ones capable of pollinating the cacao flowers. And as such, we need them. Now, this need for the pollinators, specifically for the midges, dictate the way you manage your farm. Later on, I will discussing with you, bakit bawal na bawal magsiga kapag meron kang cacao farm. And then, that will also tell you, bakit napaka-importante ng mulching sa midges. So, we will go and discuss that further later. Cocoa liquor, butter, powder, couverture. Okay, Since I'm not a chocolate maker, I have some idea, but I will let our chocolate maker and cacao doctor, Lucci, discuss that in depth in the succeeding slides, in the succeeding modules. Okay, naiwan pa yung pruning. So there, pruning is one of, if when you say cacao farming, you need to prune. You must prune. You have to have pruning shears. This is one of the best ways to control pest and disease. This is perhaps the best way to make your to make the harvest even better. It allows better aeration of the trees. So the sunlight can come in, air can come in. That's how important pruning is. And like I said, later on in the succeeding modules, we will discuss that in depth. Now we're discussing the cacao crop phases and yield forecast for 1 hectare. This forecast is presuming that you have 800 hills and that 1 kilo of wet beans is equal to 8 pods. Now, you will see that there are 2 main stages, the vegetative stage and the reproductive stage. So just like humans, there is a stage where the plant is still very young, it cannot reproduce yet, and then it matures enough to be reproductive. So we've put here from year 1 to year 10. This is the number of pod yields per tree. At year 1, none, of course, because this presumes that you have just sown your seedlings or you have just planted. By year 2, expect that a tree will have 8 pods for 1 year. At year 3, that you'll have 30 pods for the whole of the year. For year 4, 45 for the whole of the year. And for year 4, and then for year 5, that's 60 pods per tree. Now, we've taken this from the lecture we've attended with Sidami. We are just the ones who put the visuals, but these are the averages that they've given us. Of course, nothing is set in stone. Like it's possible if you're really doing very well in your farms, maybe you'll get 65, 70, 75. Maybe you're not doing so well, maybe you'll get 55, 50. You know, these are more like averages, so you know more or less what to expect. And then per year, and then you'll see that from year 5 onwards, pretty much that's the kind of yield you'll be expecting. Now, what does this translate to? Now, going to what's important. The important is, what about the beans? Now, on the first year, of course, because your plant, your cacao seedling is still too small, it will have 0 wet beans. You won't have any produce. On year 2, you presume that you will have about 800 kilos of wet beans. How? Because each tree by year 2 can produce 8 pods. Now, remember that 8 pods can yield 1 kilo of wet beans. And in your 1 hectare of farm, it's about 800. So that's per tree, you have 8 pods. And then your trees are 800 because you have 800 hills. So 800 times 8, that's 800 times 8. It's 6,400, and then you divide it by 8 because the number of pods will be divided by 8 to get the kilo of wet beans. Hence, you have 800. Now, for year 3, you have 800 hills. Multiply it by 30 pods. per hill or per tree, that's 24,000, and then divide it by 8 pods, so you'll get your wet beans, that's 3,000, and so on. Now, these two stages are important. Why? If I were a pure agriculturist, agriculturist, I'd say it's very important because the stages determine how you'll manage the plant from cultural to chemical interventions. However, because I first have the mindset of an entrepreneur, and then I'm an agriculture enthusiast second, I'd say that knowing what stage your cacao is in helps you forecast sales, and then it also tells you expenses to anticipate. This was mine and Luchi's experience when we started with seed one of OFW para sa Magsasaka. It was there that we realized if you own the land, farm the land, and you are there in the Philippines, you know, you yourself are working on your farm, the harvest of 2 to 3 hectares can be profitable. But if you are an OFW and you hired people to farm, you have an inventory of equipment and inputs, somebody reports to you, and you really manage it as a proper business, and you are profit sharing like what we do in OPM, the minimum you should look at is 5 hectares. And that still depends on how near you are to the main roads. If you have farm-to-market roads, everything has costs. So I want to show you now, what if the presumption is 600 hills? Because another thing that we realized when we started farming is that there's a tendency to over forecast, because like in the farm that we manage, some farms not only have coconut as intercrop, but when you go to the farm, you'll find out, okay, the farmer or your farm already has, let's say, it has 3 mango trees, and then just some parts of your farm, it has some jackfruit, some part has lanzones, some part has this, some part has that. Of course, you'll have to start thinking, shall I start cutting my fruit trees? Because that's one of the things you need to consider. Do I want to really just focus on cacao, just cacao and my coconut? So are those only intercrops? Or maybe I'll let the other fruit stay and, to earn from that, or maybe to just have some fresh fruits when we're there, we can have it for our own, you know, for our own consumption. So that's why I've put here a presumption as well for 600 yields. So notice that I've not changed. Okay, the number of pod yields per tree does not change. That's already that's a presumption. It's 0 and then 8 and then 30, 45, 60 pods per tree per annum. Now, the kilos of wet beans, because you only have 600 hills. See here, I put 600 hills. Now, so of course, it will change. It means that you have 8 pods per tree, and that 8, you multiply it by 600, that's 4,800. And that 4,800... still, you divide it by 8 pods, which is the average, to get 1 kilo of wet beans. So you only have 600 kilos of wet beans. I repeat, this is not set in stone. Probably, if you're really good in farming, you're good in what you do with a bit of luck, maybe by year 2, you'll have 10 instead of 8. You'll have 12 instead of 8. Or maybe in year 3, instead of 30, you only got 28. In year 4, maybe instead of 45, you're already getting 60. In year 5, you're doing 70 or 80. So again, these are just averages, but it's supposed to help you a little bit forecast, okay, what is my 1 hectare capable of producing, of you know, how profitable will it be later on. Now, did we find this in any textbook or seminar? No. For about 5 weeks after we left Davao, and the cacao doctor's training, here in Dubai, we were crunching the numbers. And we asked the same questions most of you ask when you email us. Who will buy my beans? Sino bibili ng beans ko? So again, I'm emphasizing the need for you to have some forecast, some form of forecast when you are looking at your farms, especially if you're an OFW and you are just going to ask maybe your family member, maybe your cousins or your brother or your sister to take care of the farm. This is sort of a good way to gauge how much money you'll be expecting back. And of course, if you know, generally the rule is when you're doing forecasting and budgeting. So once you know what you can harvest, then you should know as well what you'll be spending on. Sometimes some people do it the other way. First, they ask, okay, what are our expenses? And then they say, what's our forecast? What can we do? What can we sell? But I think, and this is just, you know, my personal opinion, because these are trees. These are, you cannot really force them, because there are so many factors that can affect your cacao production, your yield, your harvest. I think it's best to first find out, look at your farm. Look at your 1 hectare farm, your 2 hectare farm, 3 hectare farms. Check how many coconut trees do you have. And look at the distance, because these are so important. It's possible that you have so many fruit trees. You have, you have fruit trees, you have coconuts, or maybe you even have banana. But then they are so nicely spaced. The spaces in between are so well that you will be able to intercrop properly cacao. By the way, the very ideal planting distance for cacao is 3 by 3 meters. So it should be that in the middle is the cacao seedling, and then beside it, nothing should be planted there. 3 meters, within 3 meters, on the left, on the right, on the front, and on your back of the seedling. So we kept mentioning monocrop and intercrop. Let's have a look at this. A monocrop of 1 hectare allows 1,100 cacao hills. This means your shade will be coming from madre de cacao. The intercrop with banana allows, if let's say presume that you have a very clean, very an empty piece of land, you can plant banana 600 banana trees and plant 666 cacao trees. For intercrop with coconut, it allows 816 cacao trees and 100 coconut trees. Ideally, coconut is spaced at 10 by 10 meters. Okay. So, remember, I keep mentioning, well, sales forecast. If you're seriously thinking about investing in cacao farming, as with any business, you need to look at the macroeconomics or the bigger factors that will affect your business, your cocoa farm, your cacao farm. And that includes asking what factors will affect the market you want to enter or even your operations.
Now, I'd like to share with you part of the talk of Ms. Agnes Perpetua Legaspi, the Assistant Director for Export Marketing Bureau of the Department of Trade and Industry, during her talk in Cacao Connect 2016 just last September. This is the Philippine merchandise trade value in US billion dollars. Now, let us look at the cacao industry portfolio. How much did we import and how much did we export? Let's look at the Philippine cacao export value for year 2015. Chocolates took a 59% share, or a value of 12,478,500 $1,000 as exports, followed by cocoa beans, cocoa butter, powder, and others. So imagine, although we are a country already in need of cocoa bean products or cocoa products, we are still exporting them. And the main export is actually chocolates. Now let us look at our import values in 2015. For chocolates, we imported or we bought from outside of the country 49% of all our cocoa imports. And that is about 87,190,823,000. This is import, followed by beans, butter, powder, paste, and others. Let's compare. What does this mean for us as cacao growers? This means that number one, for exports, there is a chance for us because there is a huge market for chocolates. Now, for imports, since we are still importing chocolates and cocoa beans, it just emphasizes that indeed there is a huge market even locally. Even if you don't go outside of the country, already there is a market waiting for us as cocoa growers. Now, what are the top five major markets globally? For beans, it's Malaysia, Thailand, Indonesia. For chocolates, it's Indonesia and Thailand. For butter, Thailand. For powder, Malaysia and Vietnam. Now, it's worthy to note that if you have plans to export, it is good to find out which countries does the Philippines have an FTA with. FTA means free trade agreements, because there you will be able to save money because of the reduced tariffs or sometimes completely zero tariffs.
Now, what are the trends in the global market today? One is organic products, or food items that are known to use little or no chemicals and are grown in a more natural way. People nowadays want to know that what they eat is truly nutritious, less GMO or genetically modified organism as much as possible. And I do believe in this. Why? I personally started to become a conscious eater, well, not yet fully organic, but just a conscious eater. You know, I check what I eat or the labels in the canned goods that we shop. And the reason why I haven't gone fully organic is because here, at least here in Dubai, it's quite expensive, ang mahal eh. And leaning towards natural products about 2.5 years ago, that's when we had a holiday in Germany, and one of our cousins there was researching a lot about it. She changed her young family's diet system because she just gave a couple of years ago. She researched about superfoods, why eating less meat is good, and eventually she decided to go organic, or bio, as they say in Europe. From my side, I became more and more convinced because allergies that are not known to be prevalent decades ago seem to be more prevalent now. Like, I have a friend, every time she eats the chicken here in Dubai, it's allergies all over her body, especially the nuggets in McDonald's. Just one bite and immediately she will have allergies. But when she eats chicken which is native or organic, nothing. And personally, I was always a bit more conscious than the average person about fitness and health because I used to be a medical researcher in my early career and I worked at the Philippine General Hospital. One of the studies I got involved in had me deal with senior citizens who either had stroke or heart attack. So I guess somehow in my head, I saw the importance of trying to invest in your health when you are younger. Then our mother also developed diabetes, not because it was in her genetics. Imagine both sides of our parents had no history of diabetes. But the Filipino lifestyle of always having soft drinks in a meal, plus yung pagkain ng kanin, rice, yung taba, matamis, It all contributed to that. Lifestyle. Last year, the International Diabetes Foundation put the Philippines as an emerging diabetes hotspot, ranked 15 in the world for diabetes prevalence. Our 68-year-old mother, the same one who went with us to Davao to become a cacao doctor, has had 2 heart bypasses and 4 angioplasties. That's since she turned 54. That's why, on a personal level, Luchi and I are advocates of good nutrition and fitness. We have seen firsthand how expensive and gaano ka emotional pag iniisip mo na ang magulang mo baka atakihin anytime. That's the main reason why we became OFWs. Kada angioplasty, kung may 2 or 3 stent, almost ₱500,000 ang gastos. Kaya rin sabi namin, we need to create healthier and tastier chocolates because we're one of those people who really eat a lot of chocolates. And we should learn from the unhealthy mistakes of our elders. And that's why it's one of our goals. So going back to superfoods, here in Dubai, they sell Peruvian cacao nibs. And for us, we normally add this to rolled oats for breakfast. Or, well, in the Philippines, no, Quaker oats. But it's FYI lang, it's better to buy whole oats or rolled oats. Mas maraming nutrients, mas maraming fiber. So we knew cacao nibs as a superfood even before we found out about cacao farming. So, alongside, we also knew about turmeric or luyang dilaw, na superfood din pala siya, chia seeds, honey, moringa or malunggay, yan. Our own DA affirms one of the reasons the demand for cacao is growing worldwide is because of people's awareness of cacao's health benefits. Now, let's look at another trend that the DTI talked about in Cacao Connect last year. Another trend that is seen in the global market is the demand for halal products. I'd like to repeat that this section is taken from the talk in Cacao Connect 2016 by the DTI Expert Bureau Assistant Director Agnes Perpetua Legazpi. Luchi and I are both Muslim reverts, so balik Islam kami. So we quite understand the phenomenon behind this global trend. According to this study made by US-based Pew Research Center in 2015, Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world. I will read from their official released study. Quote, "Indeed, Muslims will grow more than twice as fast as the overall world population between 2010 and 2050. And in the second half of this century will likely surpass Christians as the world's largest religious group," unquote. Imagine right now, it is already a $2.6 trillion industry. But by 2030, according to this slide presentation by DTI, it will be a $10 trillion industry. One of my friends and fellow social entrepreneur Chitwan said after her ASEAN business delegation trip that indeed there is a waiting market sa Asia pa lang for halal foods. Now, what does halal mean? If you are based in the Middle East, highly likely you have some understanding of the concept. But let me just clarify it again for our audience who do not have much interaction with Muslims. Halal is an Arabic word and basically means permissible or lawful, permitted by Sharia or Islamic law. A marriage can be halal, clothes can be halal, work can be halal, food can be halal. And the opposite of halal is haram or forbidden. So once food can be haram, one source of income can be haram. For example, in our investment pack, we ask our investors, is your source of investment halal? Because if it is illegal, indecent, or anything that will cause problem to your body, to your well-being, and to other people now or later on, it means it is not halal. Now, what about halal food? So, I added this slide. This is not DTI's anymore. So, you'll be familiar with the Arabic word of halal. this one, which stands now as a logo. It means any foods that are allowed to be eaten according to Islamic Sharia law is halal. This means that for any food to be considered halal, it must comply with the religious ritual and observance of Sharia. I will use myself, since I am Muslim since 2004, as an example of a halal of halal market or a customer. When I travel to any part of the world, one of the things I consider is this: will there be halal food available? If I enter a restaurant, what are the halal options? Like when I go to China to visit factories, I check that the hotel is near to a halal restaurant, and I'm always lucky that there always is. Australia is one of those countries who understands this trend well. Singapore has lots of halal restaurants, so does London. Usually, any halal logo, like the ones above, will assure a Muslim customer that an establishment or a product is halal. So when I go food shopping, I look for the halal logo. If there's none, I look at the ingredients, even in baked products. And if there's anything there that has pork or pork derivatives like lard, or if there's alcohol, so yung mga chocolates with alcohol, no, no, no. Or anything haram or that will cause me harm according to Islamic law, I will not eat it, I will not buy it. If there is, immediately, you lose me as a customer. Immediately. Now, Muslims aren't just the Arabs. That's the biggest mistake people have. There are more Muslims globally who are non-Arabs. Indonesia and Malaysia, for example, is such a huge market for export of cacao products. Remember, let's have a quick look again at that DTI slide earlier. See who buys the beans? Malaysia, Thailand, Indonesia. And see Pakistan as well. Pakistan is a Muslim country. Chocolates. Our biggest buyer is Indonesia and Thailand. Butter, Thailand, powder, Malaysia, Vietnam. So you can really see there, that if you don't familiarize yourself or you do not become ready with this trend, you are losing out on a huge market. And one of the ways to go into the market is to be halal certified. This means that food has been subjected to approved certification systems which guarantee to consumers that nothing in the food has any forbidden components. Halal certificates are issued, well, normally, I think in the Philippines they make a payment, but normally it should be free, by a certifying body. This logo on the upper left is, I believe, the certifying body in the Philippines, the Islamic Da'wah Council of the Philippines. By the way, so what is haram food? Just so you know, food can be forbidden in Islam if it includes blood, alcohol, meat, or any products from a forbidden animal, including pigs and any carnivorous animals or birds of prey. That's why Muslims don't eat tigers as well, alligators, snakes. Okay, now moving on. So I've been talking on and on about markets. So your market basically is your customer base. It's either you sell locally or internationally. In the local market, you can choose to go from the most basic of the cacao products, which is selling wet beans. Kumbaga, you're selling a produce, which is ang dulo, not yet a product, because it's completely unprocessed. Tinanggal nyo lang, you just removed the skin. For us in OPM, we buy the wet beans in Agusan. Let me show you how we do it. So These are some of the photos that we've taken just last November. This is how it looks when the farmers wait for us along the road. Because what we do, we have staff who pick up the beans directly from the, at least along the road. So see here. And so we use the Skylab. And we really, for us in OFW, para sa Magsasaka, talagang we go up the mountains. I think this one, when we check this area out, the ang altitude dito is about, I think, nasa 550 meters. And which is actually very ideal for cacao growing. By the way, one of the climatic requirements of cacao is that it is at a certain altitude. So as much as possible, the very ideal is that it be, kumbaga yung area where you farm is from 600 to 900 meters above sea level, something like that. If it's any higher, like for example Baguio, you will find it hard to grow the cacao there. It's too, it'll be too cold. And then, of course, if it's, of course, it doesn't mean that you cannot plant cacao if it's any less than that. Obviously, there are many successful cacao growers, even if they grow the cacao at 200 meters above sea level only, or 300 meters. I think, for example, I'll give you an example. When I went to Cebu, and I checked on our app, because we have our own app which shows the altitude. I think dun sa downtown, it's about 100 meters to 150 meters above sea level. So that should give you some idea. Yeah, and so here we are. We weigh them, tinitimbang namin, and then we pick them up, and then it's brought to our facility. And this is our cacao doctor, Danielle. And okay, so ito na, nagkaabot-abot na kami. Ito naman, it's another example of one of our cacao growers. So as you can see, parang piyesta nun eh. One of the things that I do personally is we check yung quality of the beans, if it's grade A or grade B, class A or class B siya, and because somehow that dictates the pricing. And kasi rin, what we noticed is talagang one of the cultural methods or cultural practice of sleeving, yung paglalagay ng plastic and rubber band on the pods, contribute a lot to protecting it from disease. So, normally, those which are not sleeved, nagigi siyang bugtok. That's what it's called. So, napapod border siya. So, here are some more photos. So, as you can see, parang talaga siyang fiesta. Ang saya-saya ng mga, yan, I think class A to. And tapos sinisegregate, tinatanggal yung iba, nililipat, because what we noticed, some of our cacao growers, may mga nalalagay na hindi dapat nalalagay yung A sa B. So we segregate them. So there, the children, some of the children of the farmers. And another one of our other cacao doctor. And tapos, of course, we count them, and then we talk about the payment, and then in OPM kasi we also have a sort of extra benefits for the farmers who sell to us, like those who have sold to us, let's say X number, 100 kilos or no, 200 kilos, we give them sleeves, plastic sleeves, and rubber bands, so that at least it also assists them in their, in their financing of their farms. Yeah, so as you can see, padilim na ng padilim. When we started, it's about 4 o'clock. By the time we finished, it's already evening. So So now let me go back to our slides once more. So again, we're talking about the domestic market, and that's just a glimpse of how we do the buying, and so you can imagine as well how you're going to do the selling. Now, once you add some more work to your wet beans, you can actually dry them without even fermenting, and you can sell them already. However, and because we really believe that the Philippines can do well in the international market, we can upgrade our beans, we can produce quality cacao, you have to remember that no fermentation equals no chocolate flavor. So we really encourage you to ferment the beans, and it will also increase the price of your beans that you sell. If you sell it unfermented, it's a little bit cheaper. If you sell it fermented, it's, you know, your price goes up a little bit. Now, I want to remind you, like, just a sort of a recap. We said that the recovery from wet beans to dry beans is how many percent? Ilan? Okay, it's a 33%, or 3:1, which means if I had 90 kilos of wet beans, by the time I've dried it, by the time I've fermented it and then dried it, my 90 kilos originally will be just 30 kilos. Now, again, just also to review, 8 cacao pods yield on average a kilo of wet beans. In later modules, we will discuss the protocol that we teach farmers for post-harvest, because even that, you need to follow, you know, you need to observe some practices in order to protect your next harvest. Now, if you'd like to value add, you can choose to dry your beans in the sun. Like I said, use a solar dryer without fermenting or with fermentation. Now, you can still go higher up the value chain by going through the chocolate manufacturing process. So you can roast it, grind it, winnow it, and it becomes cocoa liquor. Lucci will elaborate on these parts later on, because that's more of her thing. That's her strength, and she's the chocolate maker in our tandem. So after the cocoa liquor, just very briefly, after the, you know, cocoa liquor is basically tableya already. Yan yung ano yun eh. That's what we sell in the Philippines, known as tableya. However, if you further grind that and it becomes finer, there will be chocolate blocks. Now, the chocolate blocks, once they're molded, becomes a chocolate bar. Of course, before it becomes a chocolate bar, it needs to be tempered, it can be aged. And like I said, Lucci can just describe and talk about that later on. Now, let's talk about the international market. How do you internationalize a small firm? According to the slides of DTI, there are several ways to go about it. One is to individually sell products to small buyers abroad. Look, if you can find anyone who wants to buy, maybe you can ship it via DHL or FedEx. You can do that. However, you need to know as well, like when Lucci went to the States and she spoke with some potential buyers, they will ask if the products that you have a Bureau of Food and Drugs approval, or I think they call it BFA there. So you have to be conscious of those requirements if you want to sell directly to small buyers abroad, because like in the States, they will not allow your product to be sold to the retail market unless they know it's safe and it's clean. Another way is to be part of a cluster of otherwise competitor firms to service volume orders, and then to sell its products to a firm linked to a regional or global value chain. For us, in OPM, we actually correspond to this second and third one, because we serve, our goal is to service volume orders. So what we do is we look for farmers who may want to be part of us, cluster with us, like what I've shown you in the vid, in the photos. These farmers, they don't want to be they'd like to concentrate on the farms, and some of our I don't have photos of, I'm not going to show photos of that now, but when we buy dried fermented beans, it becomes part of a bigger order, because when we are talking about bigger order, and remember I mentioned earlier talk about 5 metric tons, 20 metric tons, we are talking about 1 metric ton is equal to 1,000 kilos. So, and that is 1,000 kilos of dried fermented beans. So imagine 1,000, 1 ton is actually 3 tons of wet beans. And 3 tons of wet beans is actually 3 tons times 8 pods is about 8 times 3, 24. 24 tons of pods. So can you imagine? And 24 tons is actually 24 times 1,000. So that's 24,000 kilos of pods. So it's, and that's why I keep saying that there is strength in numbers. If it's better to find out if you have neighbors, or if you know, if in your barangay or in your town there are other cacao farmers, it's best to coordinate with them, because in our experience as well, you will lose out if you are selling just by yourself. Like even for us, when we started, like 100 kilos, if you're just selling 100 kilos or 200 or 300 or 500 kilos, half a ton of wet beans or even a ton of wet beans, and then you're going to spend on bringing it to the flat, to your buyer, you know, it's going to be tough if that's the case. So why not sell your products to a firm linked to a regional or global value chain? And for us, because we are OFW para sa Magsasaka, we also have connections, or we also have a network of buyers outside of the country. Like for us here in Dubai, we service the Middle East. We have connections as well in Europe, because Dubai is the gateway of Europe. And then, of course, we also have not OFWs, but, you know, we have migrants who are part of OPM, or of OFW para sa Magsasaka, who are also based in the United States. So that can be another avenue for you. And please do tell us, just email us if you're keen about that now or in the future. So I guess that's about it, about the market, about the things you need to understand about the macroeconomics, the terms which you should be familiar with. And I think it's now time to go and discuss what is it now, what will happen now once we go into the actual farming.